This
Okay.
conference will now be recorded.
Great.
Well, I was just thanking everyone for joining and explaining that, you know, this is kind of a unique way for us to hold public meetings, to do a webinar, but in the circumstances, I think that this is our best tool. And I'm very excited that there's 112 people on this webinar. So that's an excellent turnout. So thank you, everyone.
Yeah, thank you so much. I just wanted to say, introduce myself. I'm Eunice Kim. I'm the Long Range Planning Manager with the City of Salem. And we have a lot of teammates on this call. Lisa Anderson Ogilvy, the planning administrator, is on the call, joining us from her home. Norman Wright, our community development director, Austin Ross, our long range planner, Julie Warnicki, our transportation planning manager, and then Scott, some of your team members as well.
Yes, there's some team members from Fregonesi Associates. We're the consultant that's helping the city through the comp plan update process.
Great. So as Scott was saying, I've already had some technical difficulties, so please bear with us if you are having some difficulties as well. We are recording this now, so we will post this video of the webinar on our project website hopefully this week. We're going to start with a presentation, and then we'll have some Q&A, some question and answer, hopefully via the chat. Hopefully that works. But if we can't get to your questions, feel free to call me or email me. As always, my information is on the project website. And as we kind of continue to do our outreach on this project, typically we would be out and about in the community. Obviously, that's not possible right now. So if your organizations are having any sort of digital meetings, you would like us to come answer questions or be part of that, just let us know. Did I miss anything, Scott?
I don't think so. I think that the point, though, is that we have a lot of people on today. You know, we want to respect everyone's time. We're going to go through the quick presentation. Hey, there you go. You're right. You're not sideways anymore. Perfect. So I think the main point is, if we don't get to your questions, there's lots of ways to get in touch with us. Schedule phone calls, emails. We'll do our best to answer all the questions if we don't get to them today. Would you like me to share my screen and do the presentation?
That would be great. I can start if you can share your screen.
Yep.
I think it's loading.
Yep. Great. Should come up.
Can you make it big?
Yep, I'm trying.
Okay. So as you all know, we're here today to talk about the Our Salem project. This is a project to update our comprehensive plan. Our comprehensive plan, just as a reminder, is the long-range plan that really guides our growth and development into the future. So it influences everything from where different types of housing and development, commercial, industrial, are located, how people move around the city, what are our priorities for our transportation system, how we protect our natural resources. So it's kind of the overarching guide to our growth and development in the Salem area. Can you change the slide? So we're going to talk today a little bit, just a brief project overview, and then we're really going to focus on scenarios, and those are really different options for how we could grow in the future. So Scott will kind of talk about that too. Next. So yep, we're updating our comp plan.
we sure are.
So just as a reminder, our comprehensive plan covers more than just our city limits. It goes beyond that to our portion of the urban growth boundary. On the map, that's the gray portion shaded there. So this is the portion that we expect to see 60,000 more people by 2035. So essentially, this is our opportunity to be really proactive in planning how we house those people, where everyone's going to work, how they're going to move around the city. So this is really our opportunity to really guide and manage that growth that we know is happening. Next. Next. So we kicked off this visioning project last fall. We've been out and about in the community when we could be out and about at different events. We've gone to community organizations, we've gone to different community events, and now we're in kind of this middle phase scenarios where we've taken that input and come up with different options that we want to test with the community and get feedback on. So that's what the focus is today. And then we hope by the fall we have a community vision. Obviously everything's kind of in flux right now given the situation, but hopefully by the fall we'll have a vision. So I don't know how many of you joined us, I think hopefully many of you, for workshops that we had in the fall. This is where we had some hands-on activities where we asked people you know, where they wanted to see like housing, where they wanted to see parks and trails, different business types. So we had these workshops. And then next, we also did broader engagement. So we've been out and about previously at schools, at different community organizations, meetings, we went to teacher conferences. So all of that input, you'll see the results of that work today. So at the different venues, whether it was a workshop or a community meeting, we've asked people to help map out kind of the future of the city they want to see. So you can see people had stickers. The stickers looks different, the dots online look different, but it was all the same idea of trying to understand where people wanted to see mixed use, for example, versus housing, versus an industry, versus open space. So again, you'll see the results today.
And Eunice, you want me to take it from here?
Sure, that'd be great, thanks.
And feel free to jump in if I miss anything. But I think the main point to this is we've done a lot of outreach and it's super important to do that. The neat thing about these scenarios that we're gonna be presenting today is that they're based really on the ideas that we got from you through the workshops and through other community meetings. We have three different ways we've actually collected information from you all in terms of what things you wanted us to test with those scenarios. So those workshop maps you created help us design and inform the scenarios. Just so you know, the scenarios all have the same number of jobs and population in them, so they accommodate the same amount of growth. So you're comparing apples to apples. The development types are more specific than the actual stickers. So there's a little bit difference, but we tried to keep the development types close to the stickers that you all used during the public workshop. And then here we are now where we're presenting the scenarios to you as the public. We have a lot of indicators, so results to compare them that we'll go through. I think we're just gonna go through a handful today, but there's a lot of information and infographics and boards on the website that you can use if you wanted to dive deeper into those indicators. And then we'll take that scenario itself and refine it into to the community vision. This is just an example of all the chips. So we had 20 maps, over 1600 chips. So it's, you don't get much information out of this. It makes a pretty picture, but you can see that people were placing different types of stickers all over the map, urban centers, mixed use, office, commercial types, industrial types. So a whole palette of different types of land uses that we took your input on. This is the online workshop. So similarly, you see the same types, but we asked folks on the online workshops to place these too. Interestingly enough, we did that too at the community meetings where people put dots. So again, three methods for getting public input. The cool part was that they really all did have a lot of similarities. This is a good example of that. This is what we heard for mixed use types. So this was the in-person workshop map, whereas this was what we heard online, and this is what we heard at the public meetings, the community meetings, where we go out to different folks' venues. And so it's interesting, if you click through these, look, there is quite a bit of significance in terms of where people see mixed use being appropriate in Salem. So just an example of how we look at interpret your input. So if you look at this, this is just generally these areas circled in purple are where folks saw mixed use being appropriate. So Lancaster, downtown, State Street are just examples of that. And then generally, some of these other areas where you see some consistent input where we saw a commercial node or industrial areas and single family areas. So just generally, these are areas of consensus that came out of those public meetings. So again, I already mentioned this, but those scenarios were derived from that input. We developed four of them. So there's A, B, C, and D. They all have different ideas mixed in them. One isn't necessarily better than the other, but they've been evaluated through the indicators, so you can make your own judgment about what pieces you like about those scenarios. So it's not the key here is also that we don't want to choose a specific one of the scenarios. What we want to do is pull out pieces of each of the scenarios that make sense for the community vision moving forward. So we're not asking you to pick one. We're going to ask you to tell us what you like and don't like about each of the four scenarios. We mentioned this too, but the development types, the colors on these scenario maps actually represent development types. They're similar but different, as I mentioned, to the stickers that you used in the meetings, but we'll go through those quickly. So residential is yellow, It's going to be primarily single-family homes, but you will see duplexes, triplexes, townhomes, those types of residential areas as well. Mixed residential is a little bit more urban, I would say. If you notice the pictures, it's you know, townhomes, apartments, things like that, but also still has a component of single family. So those are our residential types. A neighborhood hub, this is a really interesting one. The neighborhood hub was something that came out of meeting with folks. And the idea was that people wanted to have neighborhood services close to where they live and work. So a lot of neighborhood hubs you'll see placed throughout each of the scenarios. Employment, so that's blue, that's be mostly your job centers and job areas. Commercial is red, so that would be anything from your New Seasons market to you know, your 7-Eleven to a UPS store. Those are the commercial types. Even and big box commercial, I should say that too. That would be things like your Walmarts and Targets and whatnot. Mixed use type. So that's your purple. Those are going to be developments that have a mix of jobs and housing or retail and housing. Those are mixed use types. That's purple. So you'll see these scenarios I'm going to present now utilizing those colors. Purple mixed use, red commercial, blue industrial, orange is mixed residential, and yellow is that is residential that we just went through. So scenario A here is depicted with those colors. And you can see the location where they were placed when we built these scenarios. One of the highlights about scenario A is that it has the most housing on the edges. So it was really kind of looking at the way you're growing today and emulating that with scenario A in terms of most of your new housing is coming on the edges of Salem. Also, mixed use is limited on Edgewater and State, so there's not really a focus on mixed use in scenario A. Commercial is distributed. There's no focus on a specific commercial area, but it's distributed throughout the city. Industrial would be mostly in Mill Creek and Fairview industrial areas. So that's the basics of scenario A. Scenario B is the next one. Scenario B actually has more multifamily in the south and west. So we tried this idea of what if we put some multifamily in South Salem down here, and in West Salem here, what would that look like? Also, mixed use is concentrated on Liberty, Edgewater, State, and Center Street. So you can see that down here, looking at mixed use in that area. Commercial in scenario B was really along your major arterials and roads. And industrial doesn't change too much throughout the scenarios, but largely in North Salem, that's a difference. Whereas scenario A was more in the south. So North Salem and Mill Creek area for scenario B in terms of industrial. That's we'll move on to scenario C. Scenario C is less housing on the edges. So the idea was, what if we started looking at focusing some of that housing in areas that are not on the edges? And then also concentrating some mixed use on Lancaster and some in Central Salem and South Salem as well. So I think you can see this, these purple areas here and here and here. This was something that came up also and throughout some of the community maps, was that what if we transformed Lancaster into something more than just a retail corridor? Also, commercial, similar to scenario B, is along major roads. Industrial is largely north in the Fairview industrial area. This one is the first one that you'll see the idea of community hub scenario. B did not have many community neighborhood hubs throughout, but these are these little pink nodes that you'll see throughout. And this is the idea to test, what if we had some community services within the neighborhoods to try and make, you know, what you could call a 20-minute neighborhood or a complete community. So that's scenario C. Scenario D is the fourth of the four scenarios. One thing about scenario D is it has multifamily throughout Salem. What it actually has the most amount of, and you'll see that in the indicators too, it has the most multifamily out of all four scenarios. We expanded mixed use in Central Salem and some on Commercial Street. So if you look at downtown, really what we did was, my phone is ringing. We looked at really focusing on downtown in terms of adding mixed use, and this scenario also has the highest amount of redevelopment. So that's another important thing. So highest amount of redevelopment, highest number of multifamily. Commercial is really looking on Silverton Road in the northeast here. You'll see that. And industrial is largely North Salem, Mill Creek, and Gilchrist areas. And then this one also has the idea of neighborhood hubs, just like Scenario C did. But one thing that we did want to look at was maybe expanding Riverfront Park to the north of downtown, which was an idea, again, that came from some of the community workshops. So those are the four scenarios. I want to go through some additional maps that explain the scenarios better than maybe the colors in terms of where the new jobs and where the new households are located in Salem. Just looking at this, this is where these are called heat maps, we call them, but the colors go from less to more. So you could see kind of where most households are. So this is existing. So it's looking where your housing is now. Probably doesn't surprise you too much. But if we look at the four scenarios and where the housing is distributed, you can see that they do change quite dramatically in terms of where the housing is located. And I'm going to go through these next set of four, and I'm going to click through them so you can see how the difference is from scenario A, where you see more of the housing on the edges, all the way to scenario D, where you see a lot more new households in Central Salem. Scenario A, again, compared to scenario B, a little change there, as well as scenario C, and then D. So I'm gonna click back through these just so we can go through them again, because I think these are powerful in terms of understanding where the new housing goes. So this is just new housing. It's not what's there now. We already showed you that map, but just looking at concentrations of new housing in scenario A, again, very much on the edges, very much using vacant land. Scenario B, similar to scenario A, but a little more focus on some more housing where you already have some. And scenario C, again, a little change, and then scenario D, where the focus is on Central Salem. If we look at the jobs, that tells a similar interesting story, but this is where your jobs are existing in terms of the heat map. And looking at the four scenarios, the jobs are a little, they're more similar than I would say the households, just because you have job centers that are already kind of there. And so most, you'll notice that the scenarios are very similar in their jobs, other than scenario D really focuses on this area kind of north of downtown, where you'll see an increase of jobs there. But we'll click through these as well. So this is scenario A, new jobs. Scenario B, A and B are very similar. You see a couple new things come in here and here. Scenario C, again, you see more downtown and more across the river in central west Salem. And then scenario D, again, I mentioned this kind of employment corridor. So those are the jobs. That's the maps that show where the new jobs are located. So hopefully that's helpful in understanding those scenarios. So let's look at some of the results real quick, and then we'll open it up for some questions about the scenarios themselves, and hopefully we can answer those. One thing we did is we ran, if you remember the first phase, we did about 20 some odd indicators. We kept those and looked at those. We have over 22 indicators that we've measured, all the way from things like employment mix to vehicle miles traveled to access to frequent transit. But in this presentation, I think really what I wanted to focus on was just looking at what the differences were. A lot of the indicators that came out of the scenarios were very similar. So, and those are the ones shown on the left. The ones shown on the right are different, and those are the ones we'll present today. So things like access to transit, mode split, vehicle hours of delay, and housing mix are some of the things we'll look at. So access to frequent transit, this is really was good news to me. I thought that the scenarios actually performed fairly well. Frequent transit we're considering would be 15-minute service. So frequent transit is a bus or that would come every 15 minutes. Salem's current goal is to have 10.5% of the new housing within a quarter mile of bus stop with 15-minute service. So that's good. So new housing. And so interestingly enough, if you look at the scenario, scenario A has about 9% of the new housing being located within that quarter mile of 15-minute service. So it's not actually quite, it's not quite reaching that goal of 10.5%. Scenario B is about 12% within the quarter mile. Scenario C is 32% and D. So scenario C and D really perform well in terms of putting new households with good access to transit. You see a similar curve with employment, where you have 27% in A, 35% in B, 44% in C, and 46% in D. So that's access to frequent transit. So you can see how all those scenarios perform. And then this would be another one, which is complete neighborhoods. This was something that we wanted to measure, and I think you'll notice that scenario C and D perform better, most likely because we're really focusing on some of those neighborhood hubs being located in that scenario. Excuse me. And then, so what's a complete neighborhood? It means you have the things you need close to you, like parks and schools and grocery stores. You have jobs and businesses and transit that you have good access to. So today, about 65% of your neighborhoods are complete neighborhoods. Looking at scenario A, you actually would reduce that a little bit. It would go down to 63, with the new households being about 31% would be complete neighborhoods. All the way up to scenario C, which actually performs the best in terms of creating new complete neighborhoods in terms of new households, 63%, and about 74% of the total households would be complete neighborhoods under scenario C. So I would say scenario B, C, and D all performed decently at increasing from your current number. Percent of new housing achieved through infill and redevelopment. So today you're getting about 31% of your new housing is being done through redevelopment. That's actually a really good number. I work in a lot of cities where they really wish to have a number that was that high. It's also encouraging because it allows you not to have to expand and use more vacant land. So scenario A and B were about 50% or 49% of the new housing was occurred through redevelopment or infill. Whereas C and D were up to 56 and 60%. So if you remember from those maps that I showed you, a lot of the reason that scenario D has a lot of redevelopment and infill is because we were focusing on areas the Central Salem and areas that already have development. Interesting to look at that as well. In terms of environmentally sensitive areas, looking at floodplains themselves, this is total. So percentage of development in floodplains, 73% in households in scenario A, 76 in B, 55 and 58 in C and D. So just comparing these, interestingly enough, the numbers for employment don't change that much, but drop a little bit in scenario D. Looking at percentage of development in areas that are 10% slope. So that's another thing we wanted to look at is where is this growth happening with areas, development areas with less than 10% slope. So scenario A is 3%, 4%, scenario C is 4% as well. They're similar in households. Across the board, they're similar in terms of employment. The one thing that's different is scenario D has 9%, whereas these three, A, B, and C, are very similar. One of the neat things we were able to do was to look at some of the transportation indicators based on these scenarios. It may not look like a big swing when you're getting 1% or 2%, but if you talk to some folks in transportation, say that really does mean something. So just for perspective, this right here is the state. So the state right now is about 82% vehicle mode split. So 80% of trips are done by a vehicle. Scenario A is 83.3, and it goes down about to 83.1, and B 82.2, and C and 81.7, and D. So you're actually changing your mode split in scenario D quite significantly in terms of vehicle percentage. And walk percentage goes from comparing the state, 10% all the way to 14. They perform similarly. Scenario A is about 30% walk and all the way to D at 14%. Your bike doesn't increase that much. This would be something that we would want to encourage working on, but your bus actually does change quite a bit. So you go from being right about the state's bus mode split all the way to 2.6. So I thought that was really interesting as well. In terms of vehicle hours of delay, this is at your peak hour, so this is from 5 to 6 p.m. And we're comparing all these from scenario A to scenario D. So this is a percent change from A, right? So it's basically a reduction. So you have a reduction of about 9% from scenario A to B in terms of hours of delay in a vehicle. And then you have another a reduction of about 22% in scenario C and all the way to 23% in scenario D. So you can see that from a transportation perspective, in vehicle hours of delay and in mode split, C and D are performing better than A and B. So I think that's actually it in terms of the presentation itself. We're going to have a new survey up on the project website. It will be specific to the scenarios that we'd love to have you all take. And then the next step will be, as Eunice mentioned, is doing the vision in the fall and rolling that out based on all of the input we gather through these types of meetings. So I'm going to not share my screen anymore. Put this big.
Can we take some questions?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's just take a look at the chat.
Yep, sounds good. So we'll take questions now.
So it looks like one of the questions has to do with what scenario has the lowest greenhouse gas emissions. So I should say that all of the results of all of the indicators are going to be posted online today. So even though we just went through a few of them that showed kind of the differences between the scenarios, all the information and explanations in terms of what the indicators and the results from the scenarios will be online on a project website. But let me just scroll through. Let's see. So it looks like the GHG emissions are pretty similar. It looks like D probably has the lowest in terms of emissions, including air pollution from travel. It's actually pretty flat. You'll be able to see that. Let's see, question. How does the mode split compare to current percentages rather than the states? I will let Julie answer that, but I will say that the indicator for mode split that we used the transportation model from the COG, our regional government agency that does all of our transportation modeling in the region. And their model looks at all of our trips done by cars, walking, biking, bus, as opposed to kind of census data that's commute to work, journey to work. So the data that we are showing from the model is all trips. Julie, did you want to jump in at all? Julie, are you there?
I'm here. Yeah, I think I will have to get back to them on that question because I don't think I have the specifics right now because this was a model developed result.
Okay. Let's see, what are the other questions? Go ahead, Scott.
Well, I'm just looking at the questions as well. There's a question about park expansion. Will be available under the four proposals. So we actually tested with each scenarios, we have an indicator that says access to parks. So you'll be able to see that. In terms of expansion, we didn't assume that there were new parks. So what we did was understanding that each of the scenarios would need additional parks. We just basically took the scenarios and measured them in terms of how they have access to parks currently. So that's another indicator that will be available on the website.
And we did include the parks that though aren't developed. We have that we've already purchased the land for example, though.
Yeah, that's true. Thank you for clarifying that.
And there's a question about our transportation model. So all of our indicator results having to do with mode split, vehicle delay, VMT, which you'll see on the website, they don't factor in any new infrastructure. It's just based on changes in the land use, so where different types of businesses and homes are located. So it doesn't assume any new roads, etc. Let's see.
There's a question about what consideration has been given to cost providing housing under each scenario. D would result in higher construction costs, given, has this been given any consideration? So I'll answer the second part of the question first. Yes, construction costs are taken into consideration when we're doing the scenario modeling. And some of that development is more expensive, but honestly, the housing cost for each person in that scenario was lower. So we do have indicators for affordability and housing cost that we can share as well. But that was definitely taken into consideration.
There's also a question about school capacity. So we are coordinating with the school district. We've met with them about our growth. And so we are coordinating on that. So they, we didn't do an analysis in terms of what would the impact would be on existing schools, but obviously the schools right now are expanding a lot of the existing schools. So we'll be coordinating in terms of what, where the growth ends up actually happening in terms of the vision that's adopted. But we didn't test school capacity as part of this analysis.
Yeah, I would say though that the comprehensive plan, once we come up, once we get the vision and kind of the future land use map, the neat thing is we'll be able to provide the school districts with school-age children. So they'll know what the need is moving into the future based on the comprehensive plan.
Right. And then I should say there's some more questions about specifically a bridge across the Willamette, an additional bridge. We did get a lot of input from folks, and we continue to, about wanting additional bridge or bridges across the Willamette. So the scenarios, again, don't anticipate any or don't include any new infrastructure, but the scenarios are just the land use. So there will be additional goals and policies that are written in the comp plan that have to do with infrastructure improvements, parks, for example. So everything is not shown on the scenarios. Hopefully that answers that question.
What differences between C and D drive the floodplain difference? That's a really good question. I think for the most part, we are trying to, when you're designing a scenario, you can be selective about where you put development. And I think the idea was, why don't we try and do a scenario where we, scenario two, which would be C and D, where we try to avoid those areas more than some of the others, understanding that, development and floodplains can occur under certain circumstances. And maybe that's a policy choice as we update the comp plan that we would want to consider. So hopefully that helps.
And I think that scenario D concentrates development the most, specifically in the downtown area. So it just, there's more development and redevelopment in existing areas versus development on the edges where there might be, or in other areas that are not developed. So I think it's because scenario D has the most concentrated growth, which is why you're seeing less impact on floodplains.
Mm-hmm. And I think the question about the traffic modeling between C and D, between West Salem and downtown, that kind of goes to, I think, the bridge question. When we did the transportation modeling, we didn't assume an additional bridge. So we looked at the impacts of that, and there's some pretty interesting changes. I don't think, that the difference was that high between C and D. Honestly, there was some significant differences in if you look at scenario A compared to C and D.
There's also a question about open space. So I think only scenario D includes the new expanded riverfront park north of downtown, but otherwise the scenarios don't include new parks. That's not to say we're not going to address parks. That's obviously going to be a component of the comprehensive plan. So we will address that through goals and policies. And then eventually, after a comprehensive plan is adopted, there'll be additional work on the actual parks and open space comprehensive plan that would be in line with this vision, if that makes sense.
So this is interesting. There's a question about a general question about infrastructure. So, it's really about West Salem being a large residential center, giving each scenario infrastructure to cross from west to downtown for employment is key to the future. Yes. How does each scenario include this in new infrastructure needs? So we didn't look at necessarily what exact new infrastructure would be necessary for these. What we'll do, though, is the comprehensive plan will identify those. Once you have a identified that future land use plan, that map itself. So we're just learning right now from the scenarios, but definitely there will need to be new infrastructure in any case.
Does anyone else have any questions? Oh, here's something from, they're looking at the slides. Why not mix things? So I should say this question I think has to do with greenhouse gas emissions. There is another effort that's happening right now, the climate action work that's happening. And so we are closely coordinating on all of that work related to, you know, whether it's the built environment or transportation. A lot of that will probably end up in, obviously, in the comp plan, but we're coordinating with Public Works, who's leading the climate action work on all things related to GHG.
There's a question about what parts of the scenarios are based on experiences from other cities and or published scientific research. So interesting, you know, the way that the model works is we use a lot of, there's a lot of research that went into the assumptions behind the model. So I wouldn't say that we specifically borrowed experiences from other cities, but there's some general things we know as planners at work that we wanted to test in the scenarios. So, and I would say that, the assumptions have been researched extensively in terms of what we put into the development types to try and get accurate indicators. And if anyone's really interested in going deep into the weeds of the model and understanding those, you can go to envisiontomorrow.org to check that out.
And it looks like there's a question about what types of jobs are being considered. Before we started the Our Salem project, we did do the two kind of baseline studies that are required before you update your comp plan. One looked at our, what's called our economic opportunities analysis, our EOA, and that looks at our what types of jobs we're going to need, the number of jobs, the number of acreage. And so all of that is being considered in these scenarios. Our scenarios and the adopted vision do have to meet all of our projections for housing and employment growth, both number of jobs and type of jobs. So that will all be considered. So while things are distributed differently in the scenarios, ultimately the vision will meet all of our projections. I'm not sure I answered that question. Let me go back. So a range of jobs. So we're not saying all retail versus all office versus industry. It's meeting our need that's in our EOA.
And one thing I would just add to that is that we do have an indicator for jobs mix, so what types of jobs do you have, and interestingly enough, we tried to keep that the same throughout the scenarios. That wasn't one of the things that we were trying to test, was what if we had, you know, what if we increased our industrial jobs to 50% of our job type. We just left it constant, so you'll notice that all of the jobs mix across the scenarios is the same, so hopefully that helps as well.
And then there's a question about the lack of commercial retail spaces in West Salem. We do have scenarios that consider more commercial retail, including neighborhood hubs and more mixed use in West Salem. So those are some of the options that we're trying to continue to get input on. So I'm not sure if we mentioned, we do have a new survey that's gonna be on our project website later today. That's going to ask questions specific to these scenarios about what you dislike and what you like, and any other comments you have. But yes, we do have consideration for more retail, mixed use, et cetera, in West Salem in the scenarios.
Yeah, so exactly. If you feel like that's something that's important, then that survey would be a great way to let us know.
There's also a question about the need for more branch libraries. So one of the big things we did hear throughout our outreach is that people want to see more community services and public services beyond the downtown area and throughout neighborhoods in Salem. And so community services generally are allowed in most of our different land use zones and our designations in the comp plan. So we didn't have a specific, designation for libraries, for example. But as we write the goals and policies related to community services like libraries, we will include that input. Oh, but as Scott said, our neighborhood hubs, that was another thing that we've heard a lot of. People want to see more services incorporated into these neighborhood hubs so people can, for example, walk to a shop and also a place where there's some services.
So there's someone who had wanted an opportunity to take place. What is this question here? You mentioned opportunity that takes place tomorrow, but we didn't get through the audio. Can you provide me with the link? Is that to the survey or to the website? We can provide a link to the website.
Yes, the website will have both a recording of this webinar as well as the slides, as well as all of the different boards that include the indicators, the scenario maps, and all of the information will be on there.
Yeah, there's going to be a lot. Thank you, Austin. There's going to be a lot more information than we were able to present today in terms of indicators and the maps. And we really encourage everyone to take a look at that. We put a lot of work into it. I think we're learning a lot from it. And now we want to know what you think about it.
And there's also a question here about how will the remainder of the council be receiving updates. So we were going to have a work session with the council this month, but given the situation that's being postponed, we hope to have that sometime this summer where the whole council will be there. They will hear this information and give us input, and as well as the Planning Commission. We are obviously continuing to keep them in the loop and getting input from them. Has there been an effort to improve walkability around non-residential areas? In the scenarios? So the scenarios don't go into detail in terms of like where different types of crossings or infrastructure improvements like sidewalks would go. That's the type of work we will do when we start writing the policies around transportation.
And I would just say that, you know, some of the, you can tell from even the mode split, some of the scenarios do perform better in terms of walkability. That might, but doesn't really relate specifically to infrastructure or the location, more about the, what the development type is itself.
Right. I think we got through all the questions. Does anyone else have any questions? Or is anyone on the team see questions that we may have missed? Austin, anyone?
There were some questions, especially during the presentation. And I think if we have trouble getting to all of them, we can do an online Q&A that we just post on the project website later on that address all the questions when we have time to read through them all.
Yeah, I just found one. So looks like there's a question about park expansion. Is that available? Will that be available under four proposals? So I think it's included only in one or maybe two of them. But again, we're not asking people to pick one of the scenarios as the vision. We're just trying to get input on each one. And the ultimate vision will be some sort of mix of the all four, maybe even new ideas that we hear from now on. So there could be a park expansion in the vision, even though it's not included in all of them. I think that's it. Let me just check.
There's a question about state law allowing fourplexes in single family zones as of July 2020.
Right. So that's House Bill 2001. We have not implemented that yet. We will be working on our project, hopefully starting at the end of this year, to update our code to implement that House bill. But we are in the scenarios assuming more growth in the residential designations than is currently allowed. So we have some assumption built into the scenarios that will have a little bit higher density in those single family areas. Is that correct, Scott?
Yeah, perfect. We did get another question. Has there been input from the state or the county about infrastructure or service plans / goals they have within the city limits? That's a really good question. I just want to point out that we have a technical committee that's helping run this, and we have state representatives, county representatives, representatives from surrounding jurisdictions. So yes, they are in coordination with this, and there will be some need to continue coordination after the comp plan has been, you know, this update's done, because they will want to know how that does impact infrastructure needs across boundaries. Jurisdictional boundaries.
Right. There's a question here about tourism. Has tourism been included? We haven't included any specific, I guess, amenity or facility related to tourism. Wait, I think this has to do with future wine country tours. But again, we're still collecting input, and that's probably something that would be more in line with our goals and policies. A lot of our designations that are commercial, for example, do or mixed use would allow, for example, you know, hotels and things like that. But that's something that if more input on that, that'd be great to hear. We haven't heard a lot about that so far in our input.
That's a really good point, though, and that's something that, you know, if that's something that's desirable in terms of being a tourist destination, I could see that fitting well in the economic development chapter of the plan as a policy.
Right, absolutely. Unless anyone has anything else, I think that's all of the questions. I want to thank you all for joining us on this sunny day. I apologize for the technical difficulties there in the beginning and everyone being patient with us. So but we'll post all this online. You can call me anytime, email us. And again, if your organizations are having some sort of meetings and you want us to, you know, digitally join and answer questions, we will be there. Just let us know.
Thank you all.
Thank you, everyone.
Stay involved.
Please.
This conference will now be recorded.